I don't think of Dad as the baseball player, and I don't see him in the eyes that so many other people do, because to me, he was my dad, and baseball was just a part of our life. Came home, he was the family man. He was the jokester, the character, the protector, the giver, and that's how I remember him. I didn't know him as the knuckleball pitcher. I knew him as my dad. It wasn't out of the ordinary for every single day I would come home from school, we'd get in the car, we'd go to the baseball field, and I would shag balls. My dad would throw to my brother, I would be in the outfield, and we would shag balls for hours. Baseball was always part of who I was from the time I was born. I mean, my dad was pitching the day that I was born, if you can believe that. And he found out that I was delivered by a sign on the Jumbotron saying, "Congratulations, Joe, you just had a baby girl." And it came game time, and we knew that our butts needed to be in the seats. And we were watching the game with my mom, rubbing our lucky pennies if my dad was pitching. And but that was our life, and we loved every minute of it. We had had like a 3-hour conversation the night before about, I was all over his case about getting fitted for his tuxedo. We talked about what song we were gonna walk down the aisle to, and just talked a lot about the wedding. And we got off the phone, and of course, little did I know that that would be the last time that I would talk to him. Over the years, I can't tell you the people that I come in contact with on a daily basis that tell me the exact same thing, where it's somebody in their family or a friend, and I know that through the research that I've been doing, I'm able to share that education with them and saying, go get scanned, or you know, look at your family history, or if you have any of these symptoms, then make sure that you get tested, because again, they're treatable.
My mother had hers at 40, her aneurysm at 40. My mom was 40 years old, prime of her life, having a great time with it, still could do cartwheels, you know. It was just devastating for her because she was just struck down hard, and it happened so quickly. It was a great way to be screened. All I had to do was lay there and be quiet, which is hard for me anyway.
All right, Michelle, this first scan is going to be 8.5 minutes long, okay?
I wanted to make sure that my mind was fairly clear because I'm a worrywart. Kids, you know, I had 5 kids, and you know, that's always, okay, it's not what if, it's when.
Michelle, we're just looking at some images right now, and we'll be in there to get you out soon, okay?
I want to be there. I want to be there for them. I have two beautiful grandbabies for my daughter Brandy that I wouldn't miss for anything in the world. They are my life, and I just light up when I see, especially Taylor. He is just my Pop-Tart.
And this is a normal study. There's no aneurysm seen here. Your blood vessels are pristine.
So I'm normal,
yours,
huh?
Yours
good, fine. Okay. I appreciate it, Dr. Weir.
I know that through the growth of this foundation, we're just going to continue to help patients and families and victims and research, and it's exciting to know how far we've come in just such a short time and the differences that we've made.
I think what we have experienced in the last 15 years or so has been almost an explosion in the different treatment options we have. That being said, this is still a ruptured aneurysm is still a devastating disease, unfortunately we do know that patients who rupture, more than half of these patients are not going to make it. And at this point, we can go ahead and do an angiogram. There is a better way to treat this disease. As bad as it is, there's a better way to treat this. And if we can treat this safer and better, we can potentially start going to treat people, getting people out of the hospital quicker, getting people back to their normal lives. The parent vessel is widely open. The coils are all within the aneurysm itself. You realize that you have a chance to really make a difference in somebody. And so I'm still here.
I don't know a whole lot about it. It seemed to be a normal day. I was sitting in the den and talking to my daughter.
Well, when he got through talking to Linda, well, like he said, I've got to go. I've got a terrific headache and I've got to get something for it. At that point, he handed the phone back to me and I put it back in his little cradle. And I looked around and he was, kind of doing like this. And I took him by the shoulders and kind of shook him. At first, I thought he was just playing with me. I said, "What are you doing?" And then I looked at his eyes and I knew he was not playing. It's even hard to talk about it. I kept asking him, "What can I do? What can I do?" Kind of a strange situation because when he would talk, it was kind of normal, but he didn't seem to grasp anything.
I want to find that one of David.
But then all of a sudden, and it was kind of overnight, things just kind of flipped back.
And I was trying to learn to walk. I didn't know how to walk when I first came out, and First Baptist Church sent me a walker over there to the hospital, and I was real proud to be able to take that back to them after I got out.
I just feel so thankful that he made it, and I'm very, very thankful that we have what we've got.
And the 5th of May of 2007, we got married. It was the best thing that ever happened to me. Because I'm ready to live again now.
I think that ultimately, this was my dad's mission, and I'm living it through him. And the day that I decided to start the foundation, I truly think that it was him speaking to me saying, "This is what you need to do. This is critical because this is a condition that can be treated." This foundation allows my dad's name to live on. And I know that if he were here today, he would have done this on his own anyway. You know, he would be living to serve others and to help others.